Okay, I think we can start. Thank you everyone for joining us on this Friday afternoon. Today we have the pleasure of listening to Dr. Bradley Flett, who is a senior plant pathologist at the ARC Grain Crops Institute, and he's going to talk to us about diseases that affect maize and using an IPM approach. Just before I hand over, please remember to add your comments or questions into the chat box. We'll get to them there. All the mics are muted, so at the end of the session, we'll address those questions. And for those of you who are participating in the CropLife CPD program, the assessment will be available on the CPD system in category one of the online modules. So with that, thanks so much, Dr. Flett. Please take it away.
Okay, thanks, Aliza. Good afternoon, everyone. It's basically my presentation's titled Integrated Disease Management of Maize Diseases, but it includes a whole lot of important concepts of plant pathology right through to the importance of correct identification. I've given a couple of examples of the most important diseases, and so we will carry on. Okay. Problems caused by plant pathogens. Plant pathogens cause a whole lot of problems, primarily as quantity and quality loss of crops, then abnormal plant growth, often caused by viruses, rotting and spoilage of primarily fruits and vegetables, and also in crops, row crops. They limit the kinds of plants and industries that can be in an area. Because these plants become infected in that area, it has been known that where diseases occur and are very serious, that after a while, the disease becomes such a threat that you cannot plant that crop any longer in that area, that given area. So it takes out whole areas of production. Then there's mycotoxins, which are toxins that are produced by fungi, and they're toxic to humans and animals. Some of them cause allergic reactions. And then there's the financial losses that come with plant pathogens. They are a threat to food safety and security. And a good example of major epidemics caused by plant pathogens is the late blight epidemic on potatoes in the late 1840s in Ireland, that caused famine and mass migrations. That's the reason that there's so many Irish people in America and all around the world, is as they were fleeing from the famine. And then Xylella fastidiosa is a disease that has affected olive trees. And there's plus minus 20 million trees infected. So you can see plant pathogens are not just single lesions on a plant, but can have very far-reaching circumstances. Just to give you an idea, this is a Fusarium field infected, and a Fusarium infected field. This is a maize grown under a pivot, and you can see all the dots of dead areas where the maize have died due to Fusarium stalk rots. You can see if you had to add up all those dots, it's quite a big area of infection. Then I want to just get on to the disease triangle. This is a concept that is probably the most important concept to understand in plant pathology. And that's the disease triangle. And why it's important is that diseases are caused not just by a pathogen. Diseases are caused by a combination or an interaction between these three factors: the pathogen, the environment, and the host. And your environment has to be favorable for the pathogen and the host to become, for the host to become infected. And it's got to be right for the pathogen to infect. The host must be susceptible, or it's a susceptible stage, and the pathogen has to be pathogenic towards that specific host. So without this interaction, a disease cannot occur. If your environment is not right, or your host has got resistant, or your pathogen has got very low inoculum levels, disease does not occur. So the concept that I want to get across to you is that without these all being favorable and being present, your disease does not occur. So there's a big difference between disease and pathogen. The pathogen is the fungus or the virus or the bacteria itself. The disease is the symptom it causes on whatever crop. So it's important to understand this concept. Okay, then you get a disease cycle. Disease cycles, I'm using here diplodia erot, just as an example. You start off with the fungus overwintering on the debris. You can see over on the right-hand side. And on this fungus, pycnidia that live on this debris start developing, and they're embedded in the debris. And this is where the spores are released from. You can see at the bottom here, a couple of cnidia, which are the spores that get released into the air, and they spread by rain splash or by wind currents and that in the air. They go and they infect behind the maize ear, where the leaf ear junction is. It infects there. It forms mycelium, and it can stay dormant for quite a while. And then when the ears are ready and they start drying down and the tissue starts dying, then this mycelium forms, it ramifies, and it goes in and infects the ear. And so then the next season, the same thing happens again. It overwinters again. So this is how the cycle goes. You can see this is a monocyclic disease. It infects once in the year, and it carries on. We'll get onto that in more detail just now. Ears are most susceptible 3 weeks after silking. Then a dry early season followed by rain is the environmental conditions needed for diplodia erot to occur. And that is how a disease cycle works. Now, in disease cycles, you may get a monocyclic or polycyclic disease. Monocyclic is, as we've just discussed, is something like diplodia, diplodia stem, diplodia erot, where you get primary infection going to overseasoning stage, primary inoculum causing the infection again, and so it goes once a season. When you get polycyclic diseases, you've still got this overseasoning stage. You've got primary inoculum and primary infection. And then you've got a secondary inoculum. that develops from these primary infections. So there's lesions that occur on the primary infection, from the primary infection. An example here of is northern corn leaf blight, grey leaf spot, common rust, and these diseases have the secondary inoculum cycle within the same season. And this may be repeated many times. And that is why you can get more lesions occurring continuously throughout the season with these diseases, as compared to the monocyclic, which just occurs once a season. So it's important to know that there's different patterns of disease cycles that occur, and this affects the control measures that you will implement to control such diseases. And we'll get into that in more detail a bit later when I get to the examples. Okay. The disease cycle and it's important. The disease cycle is a series of events that occur as the pathogen grows. And the importance thereof is that it explains the source of perpetuation of the pathogen, in other words, the inoculum, the mode on how it is spread, either by wind, air, mechanical damage, whatever, its survival in and outside the host, then it helps generate, and by understanding this, it helps generate information for the implementation of control measures. Okay, now it won't go back. I don't know what's going on here. Hello, are you still there?
Yes, Orisa? We can still hear you. Yeah, Brad, we can still hear you.
I can't forward it now.
It's maybe because the file is just a bit big. Maybe we can give it just if you use your cursor on your laptop.
I've got it. Okay.
There we go.
The important maize diseases that we're going to just go through is brown rust on maize caused by Puccinia sorghi, northern corn leaf blight caused by Xerohyalum tersicum, or it used to be known as Helminthosporium tersicum, grey leaf spot caused by Cercospora zania, Diplodia ear rot, which is caused by Stenocopella maidus, used to be called Diplodia maidus, Gibberella ear rot is caused by Fusarium graminearum. Then you get your stalk rots. I'll cover the stalk rots in one group. Then you get bacterial stalk rot, bacterial leaf streak, and maize streak virus. Well, I've just covered these diseases. These are probably some of the most common diseases we get on maize and the most destructive diseases we get on maize, and also gives us a wide spectrum of pathogens to compare. Okay, we start with brown rust. You can see the pustules that it causes up on the left-hand side. It causes these pustules. These pustules, as you can see in the bottom left-hand side, are initially like a reddish-brown color. That's when it's at the uridiospore stage. Then in the top part, so just above it, you can see they turn black. Means they go over to the teliospore stage. We'll discuss these stages just now in more detail. And you can see what happens is it infects at a certain plant at a stage of a certain growth stage. And you can see it almost cuts off the leaf. towards the stalk area. And it, the most damage is caused when that band forms completely and it cuts off the whole leaf. And I've seen this happening quite often. And it basically cuts off all your power, the foodstuffs and everything that are produced by the leaves going to the plant. Okay, rust has got a complicated life cycle. You don't have to know this and that, but I just want to point out to you, there's a uridiospore stage, which is the stage that occurs on maize. You can see there's here maize, so it develops on maize. And at the end of the season, it goes over to the teleospore stage on maize. These teleospores then basically, after harvest, are on the stubble or on the ground. And they develop what you call a basidium or basidiospore stage while on the ground. And these spores are released and they form pycnospores, which are this is where the sexual sexual stage of the plant where genes are crossed, and then it goes on up to the AECL stage, and from the AECL stage it infects maize again. Now the pycnial stage and the AECL stage occur on a crop on a plant called Oxalis caniculata. You've probably all seen this, these weeds. They're quite common in certain maize fields, particularly in the low veld areas and the eastern Mpumalanga and KwaZulu-Natal. More so than there are the rest of the maize industry. And this is where the sexual stage of the pathogen take place. And from there, they continue then back onto the maize again, where the asexual stage takes place. So you can see that some fungi have got really complicated life cycles. I'm going to skip the slide. The control of brown rust, okay. The primary means of control of common brown rust is through resistant cultivars. Because you've got such a, you've got the sexual stage, and brown rust develops races. And a race means just a single gene that differs and can either cause it to infect a host, infect a maize plant or not. And that maize plant must have a coinciding gene to be infected. So it's basically a single gene reaction that takes place because that's why we call it races or vertical resistance. But it's easy to breed for this resistance. However, this resistance doesn't last very long because it's sexually changing sexually so consistently and every year that new races can develop that can infect plants that were resistant the previous season. So it's important to bear in mind that there are resistant cultivars. However, this resistance may be overcome by the pathogen, and then you get infection again. Chemical control Primarily the strobilurins are used for chemical control. And that's basically what we can use for control of brown rust. It comes in on air currents onto the haarfelt from these areas where it has been through the oxalis stage, and the inoculum comes in on air currents up onto the haarfelt. And that is how we get maize rust and other areas where oxalis does not occur. Northern corn leaf blight, you can see on the right-hand side, is an initial infection. You just get that yellowing on the leaf. And then on the left-hand side, you can see it goes like a gray lesion forming, and in the middle it goes gray. That gray discoloration that it gets is from the spores that form on the lesion. Now you can clearly see spores are forming on the lesion. As you will go back to the monocyclic, polycyclic, it means it can form spores within the same disease, and it can reinfect. And this will be a polycyclic disease. Controlling northern corn leaf blight, resistant cultivars, once again with corn leaf blight, there's races. So you got it the same principle as with the rust. So you got to take race distribution into account. Where certain races occur, certain hybrids cannot be planted unless they've got the resistance gene towards those races. And we've noticed this in South Africa quite often, that certain races do occur in certain areas. And this is ever-changing. So don't ask me which races occur in which area, because it's continually changing. So chemical control is the primary means of control of northern corn leaf blight. There's many products available. It's important. What is important is your timing of your control, the plant growth stage, and your inoculum pressure, your primary versus secondary inoculum. If you can get in with the first lesions that develop, in other words, your primary lesions that develop, and you spray and you can control it at that stage, then you prevent secondary infections. So the earlier you get in, the better, and you can control this disease quite easily using chemical control. However, in certain areas, crop rotation and stubble reduction and resistance may be used to control the disease, depending on the severity of the disease and the amount of inoculum that occurs. Okay, then you get gray leaf spot. You can see gray leaf spot has got the same, it's also polycyclic, as is northern corn leaf blight and the rust. The lesions occur as on the left-hand side. You can see they're different to the northern corn leaf blight in that they long, thin lesions which within the leaf margins. They stay in the margins, but they run parallel to these margins, and you get these long, it's called gray leaf spot, once again, because of the grayness that comes in, is the spores that are being produced on these lesions. And this has got a very fast epidemic. It can form a lesion, and the lesion can start producing spores within 2 weeks. So it's got a very fast epidemic, and it can wipe out a maize crop within a matter of 4 weeks. On the right-hand side, you can see resistant a resistant cultivar versus a susceptible cultivar. You can see the resistant cultivar is still green and the susceptible cultivar is already dead. Control of grey leaf spot, resistant cultivars, and then chemical controls is the same as with northern corn leaf blight. There's many products that are available for this. I'm not going to mention products by name, but that you can get from labels or from different chemical companies that are marketing fungicides. But again, timing, plant growth stage, inoculum pressure are all important. Crop rotation and stubble reduction are also known to reduce the disease. However, the epidemic is so fast that even if you get rid of the primary inoculum through crop rotation or stubble reduction, once the disease starts, it increases at such a rapid rate that the crop rotation and stubble reduction is actually negligible in terms of controlling it. Then we get diplodia ear rot. As I said in the beginning, diplodia ear rot is a monocyclic disease. You can see on the left-hand side is a typical diplodia infected ear. The one on the left-hand side that's open, that you got that white mycelial growth on already. And it causes rot. It can cause rot right throughout the whole ear, or sometimes when it comes in later, it'll just be the bottom half. It generally infects at that leaf sheath stage at the bottom of the ear, and that's why it grows upwards. You do, however, sometimes get infections that start at the top and come down, that go in where the leaf, the beard comes out, and you get the infection coming in through the top of the ear. But that is very seldom and is generally the minority of cases in terms of infection. So, to show you, this is stubble. The top right-hand photo is stubble with the pycnidia that I discussed earlier. The pycnidia with the spores being released in what we call a cirrus, that you can see the spores are all joined together. In the bottom right-hand photo, you can see that's the pycnidium with the spores being coming out. You can see how they packed closely to each other. They literally glued to each other. And then they released when it gets warm and windy, and they can get they get distributed through the air. Okay, control of ear rot. There are resistant cultivars. However, it's not resistance as in absolute resistance. All cultivars get diplodia. Some just get it more than others. So resistance alone is not ideal for controlling diplodia ear rot. Chemical control, there's no effect. Primarily because you can't reach the target area, which is inside the leaf sheath. And this is what makes it difficult for chemicals to reach its target area where it's got to control. So crop rotation and stubble reduction are two important factors here. Because it's monocyclic, if you get rid of the primary inoculum, which is the only inoculum, Remember, monocyclic does not have a secondary inoculum cycle. If you get rid of the primary inoculum through stubble reduction or crop rotation, you can control the disease quite effectively. So it is extremely important to bring in crop rotation systems. Then you get gibberella ear rot, which is also monocyclic. You can see it's got this dark red color, like almost a blood red discoloration. On the left, you can see it appears white on the edge because of that's young mycelial growth. But when the mycelial growth gets older, on the left-hand side bottom ear, you can see that dark red forming. Then you take off the kernels, and then in the photo on the right, you can see it very clearly. Okay, in gibberella ear rot, again, resistant cultivars are important here. There are cultivars that are more resistant than others. Chemical control has also got no effect here, as it cannot reach the target, which is the silk. This infects now from the silk downwards. Instead of like diplodia from the bottom of the ear, this goes the other way. And you need, if you're going to use chemical control, you need to target that silk. And in a maize canopy, it's difficult to get to that silk. It's not impossible, but it's difficult. So crop rotation and stubble reduction also play a major role here in controlling the disease. Then you get stalk rots of maize. Stalk rots are caused by a number of fungi. On the left-hand side, you can see what a field can look like. This was a field taken and a photo taken in Bergville, where diplodia stalk rot was quite rampant, and you can see how the stalks break at the top. Gibberella, generally, the stalks break lower down, and that's how I know this is diplodia stalk rot. Here, diplodia stalk rot, the top middle photo, you can see there's no discoloration, it stays white, but it starts breaking up the integrity of the maize stalk. So it breaks down this integrity, and then the plant falls over. However, what's happened is a lot of companies have bred for resistance in terms of standability. In other words, a thicker rind, which enables the plant to stand better, even if it becomes infected. The problem with this is that it causes, when you finish harvesting and that stalk lays on the ground, then you get pycnidia forming on it, and it can actually increase your disease. So it's not necessarily always a good thing. It does have negative consequences as well. At the bottom is Fusarium graminearum stalk rot. The bottom middle, which you can see it's lower down the stem. And that's why I said you get the stem breaking just above the roots, and it can infect the roots as well. On the right-hand side, we've got macrophemina, which is charcoal rot, and this causes a breakdown in the integrity of the material, and it gets this black discoloration, which is the microsclerotia, which produces spores in the tissue. And this is important because macrophemina is generally your stalk rots occur in drier, stressed conditions. Except your Fusarium graminearum stalk rots, they may occur in wetter conditions. Macrophemina is a hot, dry condition. I've seen sorghum that's been infected with macrophemina where more than 80% of the field was lying on the ground because of this stalk rot. But it's primarily in stressed areas and drought areas. Then you get stalk rots, you get root rots, where your roots start discoloring and breaking down, and that can also lead to lodging. It's when the root literally rots away eventually, and there's nothing to hold the plant up in the ground anymore. Okay, the control of maize stalk rots. Reduce all plant stresses. In other words, make sure the plants aren't stressed. This is difficult because if you in a drought season, how do you give them water? But there are various other stresses that you can reduce to, like, for example, plant nutrition. You need a balanced plant nutrition. Make sure your soil analyses are done. Fertilize according to your soil analyses. Don't push nitrogen and reduce your phosphates particularly. That's when you get a lot of stalk rot because you've got a lot of leaf growth and you've got bigger ears. And that's when your plants start falling over in these dry seasons. Crop rotation reduces inoculum. No tillage versus plowing. We've noticed that there's this is a very controversial thing, because plowing reduces the stubble, which reduces the inoculum. However, no tillage ensures soil moisture being held and improves your soil moisture, which reduces your stress again. So it's a bit of a conflict whether no tillage or plowing actually has any effect on stalk rot. They do have an effect, but which one is affecting it positively and which one is affecting it negatively. Then cultivars, as I mentioned, some cultivars have a stronger rind than others and are able to stand much easier, irrespective of which stalk rot infects it. So this comes down to standability versus resistance. They are not the same thing. Standability is the ability of the plant to withstand lodging, even though it's infected. Resistance means it does not get the disease. So it's important to understand this concept of standability versus resistance. Then we get bacterial stalk rot of maize. Sure, a lot of you have been in maize fields and you see this whorl rot or stalk rot. If you pull it out, it's got a disgusting smell. It's caused by Pantoea, which is the older Wernia. And it generally occurs in irrigated maize where the water collects in the whorl or collects behind the plant, the leaf sheath, and you get extremely hot temperatures and the bacteria is in the soil, gets into into the wool or behind the leaf sheath, and it causes this infection. So the control of bacterial stalk rot, avoid irrigating in the warmest parts of the day. Rather plan your irrigation schedule for the cooler parts of the day. There's no chemicals known or registered for bacterial stalk rot, or actually for bacteria in general, just to generalize, there's no fungicides work for it. And I know of people that have actually sprayed chick to try and reduce this disease with no effect. They sprayed it. When I say a big area, I mean a whole center pivot with chick. They bought truckloads of chick and they decided they were going to try it. It was not effective. I went back to that field afterwards and there was just as much infection as in neighboring fields. Improved drainage of your field reduces inoculum and reduce mechanical damage. Try and keep mechanical damage to a minimum. That's plant damage I'm talking about. Okay, then you get a bacterial leaf streak. Also bacterial disease, but this just occurs on leaves. You can see the symptoms. They look very similar to gray leaf spot. Can often be confused, and we'll get to that just now in more detail. But these are typical symptoms of bacterial leaf streak. Long, thin streaks going up the leaf. These infections can get to a point where they're so bad that the whole leaf becomes tattered and dies off. Okay, control of bacterial leaf streak. Cultivar selection is important. We've noticed that there's very big differences in cultivar in a number of lines that we tested. There were certain lines that were badly infected and other lines that had almost no infection. So we suspect here there's a gene-for-gene interaction, which comes back to the races again that I was talking about earlier for the rust and for northern corn leaf blight. We suspect that. It's still got to be proven. No chemicals are known or registered for bacterial leaf streak. We're still working on this disease. There's very little known of it. We know very little of the epidemiology. For example, alternate hosts. Is it seed-borne or not? Where does it survive? And we have a project presently working on this bacteria. And we're trying to get as much answers as possible. This disease only occurred in South Africa up until about 8 years ago. And then suddenly it broke out in America. And they've done tests and they've found that it's the same isolate that occurs here. So somehow the bacteria got from here to America and it caused quite a lot of controversy regarding exports and so on. Then to get to a virus, maize streak disease. You can see the typical symptoms. On the left-hand side is a photo with the little leafhopper there. You can see that's the vector of the virus. It feeds on the infected plant, goes over to an uninfected plant, feeds on it, and it injects that virus into the plant. And so the diseases spread from plant to plant. The vectors overwinter on certain grasses, and in the next season, they come back onto the maize. Particularly the newly planted maize, they like it when the maize is still at the seedling stage. And it's this stage where the biggest yield losses come in, is because those seedlings, when they get infected, they hardly produce any ears. They don't produce ears. So, excuse me. So the time of infection is very important. The later the infection occurs, the less the yield damage. Okay, controlling maize streak virus. There are cultivars that are resistant to maize streak virus, but we've noticed that there's a yield lag. By a yield lag, I mean the energy that the plant has to put in to improve the resistance to the streak virus takes away energy that it could rather be putting into the ear. So we've noticed that there's a 10 to 15% yield lag. So if you can control the vector and the infections, then you can rather, it's better to plant a susceptible hybrid, control the vector, and you get a better yield with low infections. However, for small-scale farmers, where they might not have access to the chemical control, remembering that this is an insecticide and it's very toxic, you don't want it just lying around anywhere, then resistant cultivars are a possibility to controlling the disease. And then planting date. Don't be the first person to plant. In an area where maize streak virus occurs, the later you plant, the better, because the leafhoppers go onto the early infection, onto the early plantings first, and then later move on to the later plantings, but at a later stage. So you reduce your yield loss due to it coming in much later onto the crop. Okay, we're going to get on to the importance of correct identification of maize. And it's a pity I can't see you all, because I'd like to ask you, what are these two photos? What is on the right-hand side and what is on the left-hand side? And to just tell you a quick story about this, I was called to go to a situation that happened in, I'm not going to mention exactly names and that, but it was in Standerton that it occurred. And there were chemical reps that had told farmers that symptoms that you're seeing on the right-hand photo were gray leaf spot. And the farmers started spraying, and there was absolutely no control, nothing was happening. And yet these symptoms got more and more. Gray leaf spot is the left-hand photo. That's what they thought it was. Meanwhile, on the right-hand side, what you're seeing is sunburn. Certain hybrids are more susceptible to sunburn, particularly on the curl of the leaf, where the leaf turns and it's got most exposure to the sun. And this is particular hybrids that are more susceptible to this, but That is sunburn, and you can spray what you want, you're not going to get rid of it. So it's important to make sure that your disease identification is right. Because when I got called into this situation to go and see the reps and the farmers, the reps cornered me downstairs and said to me, look at these lesions, aren't they grade E spot? I said, that's sunburn. And they said, thank you very much, cheerio. They went and got in their cars and they left. Then I had to go and face the farmers on my own and tell them that they'd actually been spraying wrong. It is sunburn, which caused a lot of controversy. And yeah, I won't repeat the language that was used, but it was pretty foul language that they directed towards the reps. So those poor reps, I don't know if they sold any more chemicals to certain farmers or not, but yeah, they made a big error there. And this is the importance of getting a pathologist in when you're not sure. Okay, here we say, the importance of correct identification to limit financial loss because of ineffective spraying programs. Remember, a fungicide does not affect bacterial diseases and doesn't affect sunburn. It can only affect the fungus, the fungi, fungal diseases. And then you need to establish the need to spray based on whether it's a fungus or not. So if you're in doubt, please contact your local pathologist. Make sure, because incorrect disease diagnoses have resulted in unnecessary expenses or incorrect control measures. And this situation I mentioned in Standerton, it has not only happened there, it's happened in a number of other localities as well. I've known people to spray bacterial leaf streak with fungicides because it was incorrectly identified. Okay, I'm just repeating myself here. I can't repeat that enough. Is it, please, there are professionals. At the Institute, we are a number of plant pathologists, and there are the main universities, main agricultural universities, generally have plant pathology sections. You can contact them if they go closer to you. Okay, integrated disease management. I've discussed a number of disease control measures with when I went through the diseases. And I specified which work, which probably don't work, and all that. However, integrated disease management is what we're actually aiming for. This is where you will be using a number of different control measures in a control measure system, in a package that you can use to control certain pathogens that occur. IPM can be defined as a decision-based process involving the coordinated use of multiple tactics for optimizing the control of a pathogen in an ecologically and economic manner. Control measures that are available for integrated disease management strategies include chemical control, biological control, cultural control, which includes tillage, crop rotation, planting dates, all the management systems, and then resistance. Resistance is always important. Even though I've noticed in maize production, resistance has become less important and there's more and more chemicals being utilized on maize. And this is, there's a number of reasons for this occurring. This is a lot of the chemical companies now own the seed companies, so they prefer to have higher yielding cultivars, but also they want to spray fungicides because they make money off both the cultivars and the sprays. The other reason is that is coming in with resistance is that high yielding cultivars, these the modern day cultivars that are on the market are very susceptible to lower infection rates as compared to cultivars that were planted in the past, which had a greater tolerance level for certain diseases. And so the tolerance towards the disease has been reduced. And that is why it's more important to get in as early as possible with the chemical. But resistance still remains the most economical and effective way of controlling a disease. And when we're looking at emerging farmers, small-scale farmers, disease resistance is of incredible importance, primarily because of the costs that are involved with chemical control and other control measures. As you can see, these control measures all interact with each other. They include, you can see here how the biocontrol, the pathogen, climate, soil, all these factors interact with each other. And this is how an IPM system can be developed. And it's important if you're not sure of what IPM system, and remember an IPM system can differ from one farming area to another. It's not as if you can take a package from Potchefstroom and apply it in the Lowveld, or one from the Lowveld and apply it in KwaZulu-Natal. You've got to go and look at the specific situation, and then you develop an IPM package for a specific situation. And you can do this with the help of a pathologist as well. The benefits of integrated disease management. It promotes sustainable long-term disease management alternatives. It reduces environmental risks by encouraging the adoption of more ecologically friendly measures. It reduces the possibility for air and groundwater contamination by chemicals. Excuse me, I'm just having something to drink quickly. My mouth's getting a bit dry. It protects non-target species. It reduces the reliance on pesticides and fungicides by using several alternate management methods. Reduces pesticide residues, fungicide residues in the crop. And it improves cost effectiveness of disease management.